from Moblack, for those who have not heard of us yet. We are an edtech startup located in Pasadena. We were founded by economists from Caltech in 2013. You can see our co-founder and CEO, Walter Yuan, here in the upper left corner. He's also here for the conference, so if you're interested to learn more about the background story, make sure you get a chance to talk to him. You also see our scientific advisors, Matt Jackson and Al Roth from Stanford University. And we have an in-house software engineering team, so all of our platform, both the app and the website, is in-house developed. And it also builds an emotional connection with the material. So why emotional? For example, yesterday I was at the demo lecture at Kansas State University in the Kansas. And then, yeah, there was one guy, he almost started shouting during an auction, hey, this guy, he ripped me off or something. So it's, it can get pretty intense. So, but I that's the part that I really enjoy about Moblack. It builds an emotional connection for economic principles. And I think that is something that is very hard to achieve, especially in economics classes. It also provides an empirical basis for the claims that we make. So one of our classic games is just the standard double auction. We'll take a closer look into that experiment later. But this game is so robust, it works out almost every time. It's just an awesome proof to show students that the principles, the core principles, for example, of supply and demand, those are not just merely a theoretic construct. It actually works out. Students, they converge to what theory predicts is the equilibrium price or the equilibrium quantity in a market. And then I already mentioned the third point, it's experiments encourage students to think like scientists or think like economists. I mean, we all know in a lot of economic textbooks, the first chapter is thinking like an economist, thinking on the margin. What are marginal costs? What are opportunity costs? And so on, or Nash equilibrium. All these concepts, these theoretic concepts, become way more intuitive for students. They get to interact with their classmates and get to participate in experiments. And of course, it sparks the joy of discovery. The experiments, they allow for a lot of treatments or modifications. For example, what happens if you alter the group size from 4 people in a market to 50 people in a market? Or in a public goods game, what happens if only 5 people interact? What happens if 50 people interact? So those dynamics. When you submit a bid, your bid will show up in the order book. And this is just a bid from another seller. Your own bid will be marked with a little star or circle, if I remember it right. And then you just wait till the seller accepts your bid. So in this case, if this was your bid, your profit would be $1.47 minus 1.10, so 37 cents. And you can buy up to 3 oranges. You don't necessarily have to buy all 3. You can stop trading at any point of time. Also, if you're too impatient to wait till somebody accepts your bid, you can just check out the lowest ask or offer that the sellers are currently asking for. So right now you could just accept the 1.16 and you would still make a profit. Likewise, the seller interface looks similar, but sellers, instead of values, they have costs in increasing order. So 3 costs in increasing order. First cost here, 70 cents. You can ask for up to $3. Of course, if you ask for $3, I'm not sure if any buyer will accept that price, but you can update your ask or your bid at any time during the auction. So likewise, like for the buyers, you can either submit your own ask or accept the highest bid in the market. And important for the sellers is, some students, they get confused sometimes. I just want to clarify this. The costs only occur if you actually sell something. So if you don't trade, your balance is just zero. So it's like a production cost. Good. I'd say we just run a practice period, and then if you have any questions. And And as I said, this is just a practice period. I think market one or group one was the market that most of you participated. So you can, what I mentioned before, you could just show students the transactions at first and have them guess what you think is the equilibrium price in this market. And you can see it should be at around $1. $1.12. And this is, I'm very happy now. It's just beautiful. It's worked out. And then you can go on and say, okay, demand curve. You see 15 steps on that demand curve. So remember, group size in the market was 10, so 5 buyers and 5 sellers. Each buyer had 3 values. So 5 buyers in total, that makes 3 times 5, 15 values. So that's why there's 15 steps on that demand curve. That's how the demand curve is constituted. And likewise, supply curve. 5 sellers with each 3 costs makes 15 steps on the supply curve. And where they intersect, that's where the theoretic equilibrium is. And we get some more statistics here on the average price in the average price of all transactions in market one was 120. So you see equilibrium was $1.12, it's only 8 cents off. So there's a little upward bias, but very close. It converged very close to the equilibrium price. Quantity is exactly 13. So nobody made the transaction with a negative profit. That's theoretically possible, but in our case, it just converged perfectly to the equilibrium prediction. And efficiency, 100%. How is efficiency calculated? There's a theoretical potential surplus that is possible to be generated, and we just, probably because we're all economists in the room, we just realized 100% of the theoretical potential surplus. Here. Oh, actually a little bit less, but the computer probably rounded it up to 100%. You also see seller surplus and buyer surplus. This is interesting. Somehow sellers made way more profit than buyers. That's possible. You see prices were on average a little bit higher, but maybe the buyers were just less greedy or something like that. Okay, so that was like a baseline treatment. Now, you maybe already see this column here, government surplus. So now you can introduce a treatment, for example, a seller's tax, and let students experience how a tax affects the dynamics of a market. So let's see, stay tuned. We're gonna play the exact same game again. This time, trading period is only 2 minutes, and we'll play 2 periods. First period, you're either going to be a buyer or a seller, and the second period, we're gonna rotate the roles. So we see we have 3 markets here. This was our main market. This market is finished already. These markets are people who just joined late. And I was able to complete or fill up these markets with robots. So that's also helpful if you have an uneven number of students or somebody is just late for class, he can still join and you just complete the group with robots so that everybody or every market has 10 participants. That's just the default configuration. So you have 5 buyers and 5 sellers in each market. So I'm gonna finish this game now. And you can immediately, that's what I mentioned, you can immediately switch from running the game to debriefing students on the results. With the tax, the adjusted equilibrium price is now $1.23. And you see, even though the tax was 30 cents, it only went up, the price went only up by 11 cents. So this is a great question for students. Why didn't the price go up for exactly 30 cents? We can talk about elasticity and all these things, and also quantity. And again, our prices, I think it's just beautiful because probably all the economists, it converged perfectly. But even with students who have never participated in such a double auction market, after one practice period, it's amazing to see how efficient they converge. And again, we get the statistics about efficiency. And in this case, very interesting, government surplus. So how much money did the government collect from the tax? So this is Air Force One. Okay, any questions regarding this game? Yes.
Just wondering, on an individual basis, can you see who won?
Yes, very good question. That was actually the next point that I wanted to cover. Students always want to know who won. They're interested in the results, but of course, they want to know who won. So we have this nice scoreboard where you get a list of all your students. We don't show their names right away because sometimes people make negative profits. You don't want to intimidate everyone, but you can just announce maybe the three best traders. Okay, who is user 54? Oh, congratulations. So, simple game. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this game. Two-player game. You either choose cooperate, which is C, or defect. In this case, we are the rogue player. So both of us choose C, both of us get 10. If one person defects and the other cooperates, the defector gets 14, the other person gets 2. And then if both people defect, we only get 6. So we're going to play this for 5 rounds. So you're going to be randomly matched with somebody. You can later announce who was matched with people, but then we'll go over to results. And as I mentioned, we allow for different treatments, so you could run this game also. Unfortunately, we don't have time, but you could run it with a random ending probability so that there's like an unknown. Any general questions, comments? We can also talk about what kind of, is any one of you using interactive games right now in his classes? I know I rose this question already in the survey. Some experiences with teaching with economic games. So, yes, please.
Because for me, so that was a good, surprising actually.
Because
they were like nursing students, just slew. But I think the technology.
We get that comment actually a lot. Like, I don't want students to be on my cell phone. I think a certain share of students is going to be on their cell phone anyways, and our philosophy is just we target them where they're at. So, but if they're on their cell phone, at least they're doing something related to economics. So, or just participation into their final grade, then we want to make sure that there's a seamless performance.
Also, I pay the money.
Sure, yeah.
So like the top one or two, and usually they're paired because then one person will get. So,
any other? So you have used MomLab before. Who else has used MomLab before in these classes?
I did a test run last year.
Okay, great. That Santa Barbara. Right?
Yep.
Yeah. So how did that work out?
Really well.
Very well. Was it the double option market game or?
No, I teach a finance class. So.
Okay.
What was it? I don't think we did that one. It was last fall. No, sorry. I don't remember off the top of my head.
Oh, was it the one with traders? So you could be both a seller and a buyer, and you could basically retrade.
It might have been that one.
Yeah, I think Bubbles and Crashes.
It was Bubbles. Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah.
I remember, yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Sorry, I missed the first part of the session, but would you say that the target audience is undergraduates, or do you find it to be suitable for like adult learners as well?
Yes, I mean, our user base ranges from high schools to grad students, so definitely, yes.
Yeah, I teach a course with people that are returning after working in the sector for a while, so
okay.
I'm just thinking about
we also have a lot of MBA classes
for
using us, where you have young adults or adults with working experience who get back to get their MBA. Yes.
How many topics do you cover? Like, do you have a number of games per topic, right?
We called this workshop today teaching with experiments in microeconomics. I want to say microeconomics, of course, along with game theory, behavioral economics is our core topic. It's just naturally, it's easier to embed experiments or to to embed a topic from microecon into an experiment, then like a macroeconomic concept. But you see, we have some, we have a category finance and macro, so we have some games on bankrupt, a classic concept from macroeconomics that gamify. But yeah, our topics, they range from public choice, game theory, auction theory, of course, markets, bargaining, yeah.